According to Professor Bhattacharya, this means Buddha said nothing. To some Buddhist writers, this means that Buddha said nothingness. While to other Buddhist writers, it means Buddha said nothing, for it was to be intuitively understood and not explicitly explained. The former schools of Buddhism reached nihilism, while the latter remain as absolutes.
So nihilism is something, nothingness or denying the existence of anything, and the other ones are absolute truth. So he's just saying ki there are so many versions of Buddhism right now. And then when they say Buddha, some people say, no, Buddha was silence on the topic of God. It does not mean he did not believe in it. That's one view. But he didn't want to talk about it to confuse people, and he thought it was not necessary in the way he was teaching the way. So there are so many different ways, like Meena ji was saying, that yahan par bhi kitne sare arguments are different. Oh, Buddha said nothing, Buddha said nothingness. Because in there, they use the word nirvana. Have heard the, right? Hum log bolte self-realization, you can call it complete freedom, self-realization, enlightenment, nirvana. Nirvana means, the word comes from nirvana means without the, jo flame hoti hai na wo, एक दिए की फ्लेम, फ्लेम को वाण बोलते हैं. निर्वाण मीन्स वो है ही नहीं, मीन्स हमारी जो क्या बोलते हैं, इम्प्रेशन इन माई माइंड आर ऑल फिनिश्ड, दैट थॉटलेसनेस जो हम लोग बोलते हैं ना, एक्शनलेसनेस, थॉटलेसनेस, डिजायरलेसनेस, दैट इज निर्वाण. दैट यू नो आई डोंट कनेक्ट टू इट बिकॉज दिस इज ऑल अनित्य. सो इट्स द सेम फिलोसफी, बट दे जस्ट ही डिडंट डिस्कस अबाउट दैट ब्रह्मन, दैट्स ऑल इज सेइंग.
However, metaphysically speaking, philosophy of Buddhism is nearest to Advaita in its dialects. And yet there's a soft and subtle distinction between the two, and that is the very distinction that converts the best into the incomparable. In summing up, we may say that any student of comparative philosophy who has studied with detachment and sincerity both the philosophies must come to the conclusion that Buddha never taught that absolute was the final reality, though such a teaching verging on the Advaita concept of an absolute Brahman or Atman is ascribed to him by different Mahayana schools of Buddhism.
So he's just saying that there is a Mahayana school of Buddhism which does have this thing that about Brahman is mentioned there and all that, but I don't think we need to worry about all that. So just, yeah. Anybody was saying something here? I heard someone.
No, you know that series we saw on Buddha?
Uh-huh.
And actually it goes beyond the God, but it goes to the Atma. Because he says you have to develop the Buddha within you. Mm-hmm. There's nothing external. So essentially he's bypassing the God part, which is the Mahayana or whatever you want to call it. And he's reaching the ultimate. So when Krishna was worshipping himself, what he was saying was, you are the God.
So here also in Vedanta, it's not any different, because they say, you know, Ayam Atma Brahma, that is part of this Mahavakyas in from Mandukya, which says your very self is that Atma or Brahman. Because that space ka example that we gave, that hey, when you take a space in the needle or you take the entire space, it is one only. So, you know, we have to turn on that idea.
The problem is those people who follow other religions, they consider God as one. Because like Christ, you know, he had a vision that I am the son of God, and Muhammad had a vision that Allah is there. But in India, the rishis went farther and subdivided the gods. So Brahma is still there, consciousness is there, but below them comes Vishnu, Mahesh and all that, and Hanuman, and everybody comes below that. So we call them gods, they are not really gods.
I want to have this little discussion over here. So now we can go in the discussion mode. That's a very good point that he brought, and I'm going to tell you that what I have, how our teacher explained it and how Chinmayananji explains, because that's a very, we should not confuse that Hinduism has many gods, because God is only one. Thok bajake bola. So what are these other things? what is the context in it, so we can discuss that. So why don't we do one thing? We close the class, and then and whoever can stay, we will discuss this topic and other things if somebody wants. This will take only 5 minutes, and then you have any other question, we can bring it, okay? Okay.
And then I would also like to speak for 5 minutes. My understanding of karma and akarma, because that's what we're doing.
You can definitely please feel free to talk. But here he's only very briefly touched upon that. The detail is coming in chapter 4. But you're welcome to share. Do you want to share it in the discussion part or right now?
In the discussion part.
Okay, all right. Yeah. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah. Sarve Santu Niramaya. Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu. Ma Kashchit Dukha Bhag Bhavet. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Hari Om Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Hari Om. Okay. Go ahead, Geeta ji. You can do yours for just related directly to our stuff. What happened? I see her. She's still there, but her picture went away. Geeta ji, are you there? No. Okay, I'll do the other one for a minute, and then maybe by then she'll come back. So, we were talking about one Brahman, and there's Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, and all that. So when they talk about in Bhagavad Gita, you know, there are two aspects of God, right? One is pure Brahman, nothing is there, but then unki shakti bhi hai wahan pe, maya bol do unko. Yeah, you know, it's like when there is a fire, there's going to be heat and light. You cannot avoid it. It's inherent in it. Same way, Brahman is there, but its Shakti is there, and then it expresses itself. So when it expresses itself, there are different functions that happen in the universe. And we have given that functions those names. Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. It's like creation, we call in Sanskrit, it's called Utpatti, Sthiti, and Laya. Okay, Utpatti is something is created. Actually, it is not, you can call it illusion if you go in a, you know, Vedantic term, because it's like waves and ocean. So I don't want to go into that, but just for our purposes now, okay, this cosmos came into being, then it needed to be sustained. So that coming into being is Brahma's job, creation, right? And we do this Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh stuff every day also, in our life also. And so sustenance is Vishnu. His job is to sustain. That's why his consort is Lakshmi, because you need wealth to sustain. Okay, and then it cannot stay forever, because it's a cyclic thing. So once it's created, sustained after a while, and then it has to go. And that is when Shiva dissolution happens. So these functions are happening. And what they did in Hinduism, they gave a name, Shiva, and then they personified it, because we relate to it much better. You know, that's what, in brief, that's what it is. But I want to go back to Geeta ji, because we were looking for you, but you were not there for a minute. Yeah, go ahead with akarma and all that you wanted to share.
Right. So when we talk of karma, let's understand, my understanding is that when we perform akarma, there we get a result, and we get a fruit, and the two are different. So I'm going to take the illustration. If I'm walking with two rotis, okay, and I see a person who's very poor and hungry looking. So if I'll give him a roti. So the result of that karma, and by the way, this is a daan, right? I'm giving him a daan. And as you mentioned in chapter 17, they say that even daan can be sattvic, rajasic, tamasic, and even, you know, all these things. So the result of that action of daan is that I have now one roti and he has one roti. But the fruit of that action can be sattvic, rajasic, or tamasic.
if I, you know, I gave it to him and I think, well, I'm, you know, I'm glad that now he's not so hungry and I'm glad that I could help. So that kind of a, you know, pure, not pure, because that's a different word, but that kind of a nice feeling is makes it a sattvic action. And if I, while giving it to him, I think, you know, I'm such a generous person and I'm always giving donations. If I, even a little bit of ego or, you know, a command or something comes in, it becomes rajasic. And if, you know, if it happens, you know, abhi isko mere samne aana tha aur sab log dekh rahe hain aur mujhe dena hi padega. So you kind of give the donation, but, you know, you're not happy about it. That becomes tamasic. So how does that that thing become an akarm, you know? Then you think of a jnani or, you know, a yogi or whatever. If he's walking along and he knows that whatever situation he finds himself in is a result of what I say is heredity times environment. Heredity for all of us, heredity for, even for the yogi, the jnani, is the, his past karma, and the environment is everybody else's karma that he is going to, his karma is going to act out in the context of everybody else's karma, of the you know, whether there's a fire or an earthquake, as we say, there's so many other situations. So he knows, he's just walking up because he understands this. He's walking in his, you know, like anandamay mood and with the two rotis, and this person comes in front of him, hungry and, you know, poor looking. So he gives him a roti and he walks on. There is no feeling of, well, I'm glad that he's not hungry anymore or anything like that, because he knows that that person is also, is there because of his heredity times environment. And so he was destined that moment to get that roti, okay? Now, so that action of his is not going to produce fruit. It's actually a very pure action from a very pure motive. Understanding from the jnana, from the understanding. It did not disturb him. He was like the ocean, which we talk about. That before he had two rotis, he was fine. He has only one. That guy has one. He is fine. And that's all. Now, the reason we say that being even sattvic, why does Bhagwan say rise above the three gunas, transcend the three gunas? Because even if you do something with a pure motive, like, you know, I'm glad that he's not hungry anymore, therein lies the seed that suppose at that moment a dog came along and took the roti away, okay? Then I would be a little, oh no, the poor guy's still hungry. So I'm exposing myself to the ups and downs, the opposites, you know? The joy and the dismay, the, you know, man apaman and all that kind of thing. So that is why sattvic is also not the best state to be in. That is why we should even rise above that, realize that whatever is going on is me acting because of my heredity times environment and everybody else acting because of their heredity times environment. Okay, so, and what would the jnani, the yogi think? If the yogi is giving
Omaji, I am muted.
I'm sorry, what? Who's that?
I can't hear you.
No, Geeta is talking. I'm not talking right now. Who is saying that, first of all? I'm not even sure. Who's talking right now?
Smriti.
Smriti ji. Yeah, it may be some issue with your internet because everybody else can hear, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it may be because your picture is frozen also. Go ahead, finish.
Okay, so if, whereas a yogi, if the dog came along and took the roti away, he would say, fine, it means that the dog's, you know, that roti, it was in his bhagya, you know, mm-hmm. It was not in the fellow's, you know, the poor guy's. Although, of course, this person, as well as a yogi, would then say, no, please have the second, you know, as roti also, he would offer his second one. But maybe the sattvic fellow will think, well, okay, now what am I going to do for my lunch? Whereas the yogi is going to think, well, maybe in my bhagya it was, you know, vrat today. And he's, again, he's not bothered. He is always in that anandamay mode, whatever is happening. And therefore, that is my understanding of what is akarma, or being nashkarmya. That whatever you're doing, you are doing it with the understanding that it is all of us acting out our heredity times environment. And whatever is happening is fine. And well, you have that much control also, of course, over your own hunger and stuff, that it doesn't bother you if this is now going to be a vrat day for you. Of course, you have to have that much training also. And the other point I want to make, yes, so in the shloka where it says that, you know, karmanyam adhikaraste ma phaleshu. So they're saying we have the right to action, which is the dan, for example, but not the result. They're saying not the pal. Here the pal is the result. And this, they're saying that because you don't know what the result of your action will be. Will that guy get it or not? Or will the dog get it? Or maybe you'll lose your balance and it'll fall in the mud. And nobody will get that first roti. So the result of that action of dan is not in your hands. Okay, you have no right to the result of the action. But you will still get the fruit of that action depending on the motivation with which you performed it.
Yeah, so I think it is in line with everything that, you know, this subject is so subtle that when it comes to explaining it, everybody kind of can explain it from their own angle. And everything, whatever you said, it feels totally in line with what we are saying over here. So it's not any, that's good that you explained it in a different way. So anybody else has any question or comment?
I agree with what she explained. The only difference is a yogi, when she calls it, is not a physical yogi. He doesn't exist as a human being.
Mm-hmm.
He is in that mode where he's in the meditation mode, like he's in yoga mode. And so he as an entity, as a physical person, is different. So anytime he becomes a physical person and does those actions, they are, like you explained, sattvic, rajasic, or tamasic. But when he goes in yoga mode and he does those actions, then it is, there's no consequence. Like Lord Krishna did everything in that mode all his life. So no karma was formed when he did any action.
Yeah, that brings me to one more point. No karma, no fruit was formed.
Right.
And the reason we don't want the fruit is because fruit is binding. Because then we have to come back to this earth to work out
exactly.
That fruit.
Mm-hmm.
And it delays the ultimate goal, which is the reunion of our soul with the cosmic consciousness, you know.
It's
so,
a stack of karmas.
Chakkar chalu rehta, that's what you're saying. Chakkar is continuing, because fruit is always in the future. So to enjoy the fruit, I got to come back again.
Right. So we want to cut down our fruit. That's why we want to purify ourselves so much that our actions don't produce the fruit.
Right.
I could give a very good example of, if I can speak for two more minutes.
Sure.
It's what our, you know, I have a special needs son, right? And so our guru, and Manju Sikri is not here too. It's amazingly, her guru said the same thing about her special needs daughter that my guru said to us. That these people, these, like, because he can hardly speak, they are actually purified souls who were almost going to be united, you know, but they did something and they had to come back to this earth to work out a few of their karma, you know, to receive some of the good and bad fruit of their karma, you see. And the thing is that because he doesn't have a buddhi, right, he is unable to do any good for anybody. And at the same time, he is unable to harm anybody the way he is.
Mm-hmm.
So he is not developing any, he's not acquiring any fruit in this life. So now he will not have to come back after this life. He will go and be finally united. So Guruji's saying, of course, was that, you know, be grateful that this pure soul has come to you in your life. Serve him well and just wish him on his way, you know. That's it. That's what I wanted.
No, thank you for sharing. Yes, no, great. Anybody else? Sushilji?
Then there one story also that somebody can come as a cow because you have to fulfill your karmas which are stacked up, and so when you come as a cow you don't do any karmas.
Well, animals, they say that they don't create any more impressions. That's what they say. Humans are the ones. They say we are like standing in the middle. We can either go up or go down, you know. But we want to be encouraged to think that we are going up, you know. We don't want to go down. So.
But what about the people who are faced with this situation of bringing up the kids? Is that their karma then?
Gita ji can say it is. Karmas are very complicated. In fact, one place Krishna Bhagwan say karmo ki gati koi nahi jaan sakta, because even bade bade gyani bhi nahi, because it's such a complex thing. So nobody gets something for no reason. So we are also tied up in that. And one of the theories, you know, I watch a lot of NDE shows. So there in that, you know, what happens is in some person who is a special need in this world, the moment they quit the this world, they are totally like have no issues. They are as normal as it can be, because sometimes those mediums,
yeah,
they call them.
It's good for them.
Huh?
It's good for them.
So good or bad, at that level, they say everything is good. Only we'll put it in good and bad. Everything happens because that was necessary to our spiritual growth. So some of them said that sometimes the very high souls take upon that role of coming on this earth a special need so that the person next to them can progress spiritually. That's another angle, and a lot of them confirmed it. That they actually, because they all almost have this whole hierarchy that when you are in between the two lives, many master, many lives, may you read about that. When you are in between the two lives, there are spiritual beings who help you plan your next life for the spiritual growth. So they actually believe that we choose our parents and we choose the circumstances. And in that meeting, some very high soul will say, okay, I'm going to come as this so that it will help you to progress. Because if we look at our own difficulties in our life, we grow the maximum when we have the difficulty. When with children, with business, with whatever, if you look back, you say, oh my God, if that didn't happen, I would have not spiritually grown. Like in our study group, we used to always say, you know, agar hum dunya mein bahut khush 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 hote to aate bhi nahi yahan pe. Because the world slaps us and makes us so unhappy, say, oh my God, God, please help me. Then we go turn towards spirituality, you know. So that's another angle to look at it. But others can comment.
I have a comment.
Shireen had a question. Did that answer your question, or you want to ask your question in a different way?
No, but, you know, I feel this is all karma, you know. The kids that come to you, they are supposed to come to you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Whether they are coming to teach you a lesson or to give you the boost to become more sattvic or whatever, you know, I don't know about that.
Yeah, that's what
they... It's a lot of work. A lot of work to bring up a child.
I have one comment on this.
Sure.
Why are we here? That's the question.
Mm-hmm.
So there are three roles we are playing here.
Mm-hmm.
One is through our previous lives, Manomaya Kosha, we have our karma and desires, you know, which we are fulfilling.
Mm-hmm.
Second role we are doing is we are like a mosaic in this world. It's like the necklace, you know, we are a piece of it. So that role is automatically happening, which you can call Arjun fighting the war or whatever, or us producing children to replace us, and they are doing good to the world, or whatever we do. That is number two. And number three, and this is like we are all born incomplete, and we are moving towards completeness without our knowing or not knowing. So now you can figure out of all those three, we are covered. So the only difference happens is when you get triggered by universal mind, you are still doing those three things, but now you are aware of what is happening. And you may not be aware all your life, and all three things are happening to you. And so this is where the way the life goes on.
The third stage, that is born incomplete, we may also die incomplete.
No. Born incomplete means we are moving towards completeness. If we are complete, we are born.
But we may not be complete by the time we die, what I'm saying.
Yeah, then you will
have multiple births.
That is your multiple lifetimes. Now you could be in the first phase of the moon, like I was telling, or you could be in the 15th phase of the moon. So you are about to be complete, or you are not complete, farther away.
So but how many stages are there?
No, I'm saying nobody is up or down. You are in a different path.
Yeah.
It's based on your previous lives. So what is happening is the universe, and now this is where the universe comes in. The universe is total. Now you are part of that universe, but you don't repeat yourself. If you have done something in your previous life, you're not going to do it in this life. So your universe is total universe minus what you have already done in your previous life. So your universe is different than my universe. So you cannot say, I have to do the same thing exactly what you are doing.
Yeah.
Because you are in a different stage of life. So another Shiv Sutra is that nobody is above or below you. They are both in their own place. So
I think Sushilji wants to say something.
Or this guy is very rich or whatever, because you are where you are supposed to be.
So everybody is unique situation, unique this, unique that.
It's a unique universe, yes, and unique path.
Yeah.
So you cannot follow Christ and become Christ. You cannot follow Buddha and become Buddha.
Sushilji, okay. Go ahead.
What I was going to say was, when you say your next birth will be what you have been doing here because of your karmas, actually what it says is not only you, it's the people who you associate with, what their karma is, how you associate with them, where you are born, is not just because of your doing. It is because of the others. It's not just your own karma. It's the karma of the people you have come in contact with, what you have done with them, what they think or how they work with you. It depends on all of them, not just your own karma.
That's why I call it heredity times environment. All of that is the environment. Right, Sushilji? It agrees with what you're saying?
Yeah, it is what they are talking about is, it's not just your doing, it is, you are just a part of where you are going to go or how you are going to be born, where you are going to be born. It depends not just on yourself, not just on your doing, it is others also. If I am born with a certain parent, it's not that it was just because of me. It's because of my parents, what they wanted also, how they want, what their wishes were.
True. I think
true. Whatever they did, is because of that. So it's not just yours doing. That's all I'm saying.
But since you yourself are God, every one of them has responsible for themselves, and they are also God. So when they come and show up to collect their karma, they are doing it themselves, not because you are doing it. See, you are individual, and you are individual part of this universe. And they are all connected. So it's not like you individually are deciding all this. I don't know if I...
Yeah, I think that both of you are in your own station. You are correct.
Otherwise, it becomes like very complex situation if other people influence you in such a way.
See,
and that becomes so difficult, more complex.
Yes, so, come back to Bhagavad Gita, everybody, please. Because I think whatever you guys are saying, some indications are there in Bhagavad Gita about it. Like for Shireen, you said that, hey, this may not be my final life, right? I might have more. So then Arjun had the same question in chapter 6 when he said, hey, okay, I gave up this worldly stuff, you know, and I'm doing this karma yoga, and you know, it's hard to do from the worldly perspective. I'm giving up so many things, my desires, this, that, and now I'm going on this path and like my body quits. So am I going to just kind of disappear like a rent cloud, you know, broken up, and what's going to happen to me? So going to say, don't worry, whatever you have done, it's not going to go waste. So it, you are going to be born at the appropriate time to continue your spiritual journey. So I think when it comes to karmic thing, don't get, what is going to happen, this, that. Focus on what Krishna Bhagavan is saying, you know. And then he also said that the karma ki gati is very, very difficult. Even bade bade gyanis don't understand. So I think we will waste our time if we psychoanalyze it, what, how, when. And watching all these NDA shows, the people who are on higher realm, they have the entire picture of the mosaic. They know where your progress is going to be the best. That's why they say accept whatever you get in this life as a prasad from God, because you may not see it. That is the right parents, right circumstances, right job, right children, right everything for you. Don't fight it. Do it. Do all your purusharths to not in the worldly sense to change anything. Do the purusharth for the higher self. So the tips are given, because what our problem is, you know, we go, oh, wo karma mein kya hota hai, ye wo. We can have five different classes, we will not come to a conclusion. And it's not necessary, because we are, our buddhi at this stage is extremely limited. And the people who have gone on the other realm and come, they realize the futility of this, that, hey, why this, why that? And one of the perfect example that I like is that if a snake falls from a tree, a scientist will say, kaun sa snake hai, kya hai, kya nahi? And the other guy, wise guy, just gets away, because the snake is going to bite you. So the best is to get away. So they're saying, you have been thrown in this sansar, try to see how you can get out. Don't psychoanalyze too much. That's what Bhagavad Gita is telling you to do. My 2 cents worth. Now other people can bring up the arguments.
No, I just want to say one sentence. I mean, we just have to look at the higher goal, why we are here. True. And let's work towards it. We are put in a situation, let's work from this situation to the goal. That is what we have to do. And basically, you know, everything to do that.
But we are already doing it, and it's happening without our knowledge.
Right, but if you know it, it's then you can progress a little, maybe faster or towards it. If you don't know it, even then it's happening. True, very true. For a person who has not gone through it, who has not really, he's going to go automatically. It's just like having a birth as animals do. They just progress further up. They don't go down, they go up, right? Mm-hmm. In there, and so we are also going. The one who doesn't know is going to go up. But if you know it, then you can progress a little bit more.
But the only reason you know it, because your time has come.
True. That also is true. Yeah.
So it's part of the cumulative karmas you have accumulated in your previous lives. So you decided that the Gita is the right place and Chinmayanand is the right guru and everything.
I agree with you there. Yes. Yeah.
So maybe it's covered. It's like the universe is taking you there.
It's taking, yes. Yes, the flow is there. It's the river that's going towards the ocean. You just all.
And the karma stack is not going away. You have to exhaust that too.
We have to exhaust it. But then, yeah, I mean, again, he's directing it. But then there is a way that you can reduce more of getting it while you're exhausting it. You know, if you're on that path.
If you exhaust in karma mode, you are exhausting it and reducing it.
Yeah, true. That's what I'm saying. So reducing it to some extent.
See, all of us in this group, we have done some really good karmas to be able to study Brahma Vidya. That's what they say, that when your stack of, you know, sins go down a little bit, that's when you can connect to the Brahma Vidya. So give yourself a pat in the back that you got the jackpot. No, all of us, everybody in this mosaic, like he's saying, is not just one person, all of us together.
I believe that you have to go with the flow. and not whatever you get in life is a prasad. Just take it and go with the
prasad. Yes, there's no question.
If you try to restrain it or not happy, then you make yourself more unhappy.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So all of you in your own thought process are correct. But this subject is so subtle and so vast that people explain it differently, or it's like the...
Everybody's circumstances are different.
Yes, yes. Yeah. But the core of it is the same. The core of it is the same.
Umaji had one thought, and that was that we are going for the Upanishad, Katha Upanishad. Most of us, quite a few of us, came in between when we started the Mandukya Upanishad. If after finishing the last shloka, if we can just go with the verses of Mandukya Upanishad, just the Mandukya Upanishad, I'm not saying Karika, and then go a little bit about each, so that all of us are at that point that we know what we have done in the Mandukya Upanishad, you know, I feel like then it'll be better to go over just those 12 verses.
Yes, I think that I'm glad you said that. That exact thought came to my mind that maybe I should, because a lot of people came different times. So I think we can do that, definitely.
It'll
be a revision. And for the people who stopped and came in the middle, yes. And then if you, there's one more thing I would like to suggest is that Sarvapriyananji has given many talks on summarizing what Mandukya is. And I would encourage each one of you to at least listen once of his summary of Mandukya, because he is brilliant and he will explain it very well what it is. But we will do that.
We have listened to it, but once you talk, once a person is going to talk directly, it'll make difference for everybody in our group. If you think it's good
idea. Yeah, no, it's a great idea. So what we can do is, next week is the last shloka, so we'll finish it. And the week after that, we'll summarize it. And then we will go to...
Then after that.
Yeah. That's fine. No problem. Thank you for a good suggestion. Yeah. Okay. You think that any other burning thing is remaining?
Also, one more thing.
Sure.
The verse that we did in Mandukya Upanishad. You know, to my mind, it's just my thought. You know, I was maybe making a reason for myself. When he said nothingness, you know, Buddha stopped there, nothingness. To me, it was like we in Vedanta always say it can only be directed. A direction can be given. Guru, Sadguru can give you a direction. He cannot take you, basically. You have to go yourself.
True.
And so that is objectless, that awareness. You cannot describe. How can you say anything about that state when it's just... Therefore, he just stood silent. To me, again, as I'm saying, I'm just justifying for myself.
No, it's a great justification.
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
That because you cannot say anything about that state, therefore...
He came silent. Yeah, because Buddha was enlightened one. We call him the enlightened one. So we cannot say he didn't know. So maybe he felt like... It was not necessary, because like they say, the truth described is truth defiled, almost.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
So it's like, whatever I say is not going to be perfect anyway. Let them experience it themselves and come to their own conclusion. Yeah.
Because whatever we say is going to objectify, it's going to limit the unlimited.
Yes.
And say, therefore, we cannot say. So that's how I reason just for myself. Now that I've studied.
No, that's a very good. I'm glad you said that. Very profound. Yes, true.
Is gunge ki mithai?
Hanji, yes. Prasad. Yes. Yeah.
Joe is thinking of mithai still.
I'm waiting for my kala jamun.
Are you diabetic? Do you have diabetes or something?
Don't worry about it. I am already there.
You can make it with some other good ka bana do, good ka kala jamun. It is less
that's hard. Why they Shivji told me there's new medicine coming which will fix you.
It's good you are in direct communication with Bhagwan Shiva.
I know he's the one who's making me do this work. Are you doing, Sushil? You look so serious.
He's not making you, he's inspiring you to do all that.
No, he has a ritual behind me. He's saying you better finish this.
You know, one great thing about Vedanta is that everybody can argue their point to the highest because it's such a vast thing.
Because I know you told me that all these gods, but they are different. In other words, you can experience their energy
of course.
Ram versus Krishna differently.
Of course you can. It's like, okay, the government is there. And the president is there, but uske department bhi to hain, to har ek ki energy alag to hogi na. You know, the finance ki wo money wali hogi, and the defense ki dusri wali hogi.
It is not like the Bhagwan ka experience where you don't exist. It is like your other body is experiencing those.
Yeah, true. So everything that you're saying, there's no denial in Vedanta about it. See, that's what it is, that everything that people talk, there is a room for it in Vedanta.
Because the five bhavas of Krishna are real. You can really experience them individually.
Real in
you'll know if you haven't done it already.
When you say real, then again, then Vedantis will argue it's a relatively real. Huh? At the ultimate state, even Bhagwan says, I don't have all those bhav vav over there in my Brahmic state. This is in the Prakriti state that he has it. True.
No. Actually, every human being experiences those in your life, but they are for short time. Like you have a baby, you experience the Vatsalya Bhav.
Of course.
But then when the baby grows up, it's gone. But when you have baby Krishna, it stays with you. Because he never grows up.
No, when you say it goes away, just your own children, may have become older, but you go see their baby picture, immediately Vatsalya Bhav comes. Because you remember those days. Then you might say, I tell my boys, what happened to you guys? You're like, I'm so sweet over there.
Somebody sent us this little baby with masks.
Yes.
They were eating food.
Sushil. That was so cute. They keep putting the mask. Yeah.
But isn't it true that all this is because we're trying to explain the creation? And we are in the creation and we're trying to explain the creation.
True.
So all that... all the different gods, we gave names to them, to the power, to that one power, we have given names so that we can explain that creation.
See,
and that's it. Otherwise, there's just one Brahman, that's it.
True, but it's a road to reach there, it's a road to reach.
If you read Japji Sahab, he talks about that these are Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, but then there's one behind them, is the one he talks about.
Brahman then, is that...
Yes. It's all in Japji Sahib written also.
It's coming in Bhagavad Gita.
So Indian rishis have subdivided them like to the level of what I call them, they are shopkeepers. If you give them tapasya or upasana, they'll give you energy back. With the god, it doesn't matter.
But
looking for tapasya.
But coming back to Bhagavad Gita, Krishna Bhagavan says, don't get caught up into all these things. Directly come to me, that Brahman. Again and again, he tells Arjun, there are two paths. Path of, Chandra and Su, this thing, sun. Go directly to the sun. So it's up to us. If you want the long road,
Tuesday,
it's there.
Every Tuesday, Hanumanji ko prasad chadao, to you'll get the benefit.
Well, you can do that. Nobody's stopping you, but then you will get the limited thing.
But again, it's the same energy.
If you do with the understanding...
Middle pen.
I'm sorry, what?
Eliminate the middle
pen. Yeah, that's... Or what you are saying, is also true that if you understand the ideal behind the idol, that's what he says. If you understand them, then it's okay. But if you just think, Hanumanji is it, then there's going to be a problem.
No, but in Gita, he asked the question because he said that there are Satvik, Rajasik, Tamasik gods and the people who follow them, they also follow me because they all come out of me. And then Arjun said, why we use the middleman? Why don't we go directly to you? And you know what the answer came? He said, to worship me, you have to go through multiple lifetimes of purification before you will be able to worship.
No, I want you to bring that verse then.
Huh?
That what you're saying is very confusing.
No,
I want you to bring the verse.
Yeah.
Because sometimes what happens is like the same danger that they will say, oh, Krishna Bhagwan said this. He may not never have said something like this. But bring that verse and then we will discuss
it. Okay, we'll bring it. Mm-hmm. But do you remember the one where he said?
Well, this is what he says, that when people...
Kuch log bhoot preet ko poochte hain.
No, bhoot preet, that's not... When they said bhoot preet, Swamiji tells something else over there. But that... Because he said bhuta means we...
Gita, it's nothing to do with Swami.
No, I know. But when they say bhoot means we think that they're talking about some ghost and all that, he's saying, panch maha bhoot mein, you're just worshipping the matter. When you say, when money-minded you are, then you are worshipping bhutas. Or, you know, I want this position, or I want this. Then you are not going for the source, you're just going for the worldly things.
And Arjun asked the question, why don't I worship you directly? Because even... another question was that all these Rishi Muni, they don't worship me because they think, although I am the Adi Karan of these. And so he asked that question too. He said, you mean to say, I used to ask that. You mean they don't even know that God exists? Because if you read the Bhadranayake or some Upanishad where they used to make their own sun and their own universe.
I think what you're talking about is it is going to come. I'm trying to think of the chapter where when he says, Krishna Bhagwan says, the people who worship other gods and goddesses, deities, they are actually worshiping me only because I am behind all the power. And the example is that, okay, there is a government there and then all the officials of the government, United States of America gives them the power. They are individually nothing, you know. So that power comes from the higher self. That's what he's saying. So he's saying they unknowingly, they're worshipping me only. But because they don't know who I am, that's why they don't come to me. They just get stuck in that realm. But if you know that the power is coming from me only, then it's... But like...
I used to wonder how come all these Rishi Munis don't know that the God is the Adi Karan of them.
Oh, they know extremely well. If we think that they don't know, no, they know. That's why they are called Rishi Munis. Well, you know, they know in their heart.
They know. I'll find that for you.
Yeah, find it. Okay, anything else? Should we close?
Yes. Yep. Okay.
All right, everybody. Stay healthy and happy. We'll see you next week.
Bye-bye.
Bye.